That's a great question. If you've missed church, which many of us have, and you want to catch up with the other questions that we've been looking at, then they're all on our website and our app, and you can catch up with the audio at least of that, although we're back able to do video today. But today's question is, this question is, Christianity anti other faiths? How do we live in the tension of the plurality of our world, where not everybody around us believes the same thing as us? In fact, not everybody around us believes in anything, really. How do we cope with that? How do we navigate as Christ followers and do that in a way that is honourable to God, but yet is not compromising to what we believe? I don't know if you face that dilemma. I face that dilemma all the time. And we've looked at this as a premise, a couple of premises, that unanswered questions are fine to have, but actually what's more dangerous than unanswered questions is unquestioned answers. To believe something and not quite know why you believe it. And out of that, we have a responsibility as Christ followers to and believers to give a reason, a reasonable reason as to why we believe what we believe. That doesn't mean we have to understand everything we understand about what we believe, but to give a reasonable answer. And so we've been looking at this for the last month or so from 1 Peter 3:15, which is in the New Testament, where the writer, who's an apostle, Peter, said, "But in your hearts revere Christ as Lord." In other words, something's happened in your life that you have accepted that Jesus is more than an ordinary human that lived 2,000 some years ago, but he is worth the following with our lives, that in him we find what we cannot find in ourselves. In him we find forgiveness, in him we find direction, light of the world, all that stuff. So if that's happened to us, and for many of us that's happened, for some of us that hasn't happened yet, but if that's happened, then here's the responsibility. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that you have. But then this very important last sentence, but do this with gentleness and respect. Now I and us and the Christian church generally and over its two millennia have not always been known for our gentle and respectful answers to questions that have been asked us. And to some degree, we need to own that and repent of that and try better not to do that. And when people ask us a question, well, what about this or what about that, that seems so foreign to our ears or foreign to our beliefs, it's just easy to be in a default position of defensiveness and a lack of gentleness and respect. So how do we overcome that without being ashamed of what we believe in? Because I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it changed my life. And it is the power of God for the salvation for anyone who wants to believe. So a way to get into this, way back in 1788, I was in year five at school. Way back in 1788, there was a famous poet, a guy called William Blake. And William Blake wrote a book, not a poem, but a book called All Religions Are One. And he kind of encapsulated this idea that really, when you think about it, all religions, all belief systems are exactly the same. That every religion is true in its own way because they're really all saying the same thing. Well, William Blake must have known a lot about poetry, but not a lot about religion, because the truth is that many religions actually believe the opposite thing. Recently, a professor of religion, a guy called Stephen Prothero, notes that this is a very old claim that all religions are one. He noted that we don't make that type of claim in any other sphere of life, not in politics, not in economics, not in education. Democracy is not the same thing as fascism, and capitalism is not the same thing as communism. One of them is one thing and another is another thing. And we have the reality and the stats to see which one actually has benefited the world to a larger or greater degree. How do we believe what we believe and still do it with a credible, reasonable way, but yet remain gentle and respectful of what everybody else believes or somebody else believes or not believes? I was walking fairly recently with a group of guys. There was four of us. And we all happened to be carrying sticks and chasing little white balls. It's a custom among middle-aged men. You hit this little ball, and then you hope that you find that little ball. And then guess what you do when you find it? You hit it again, and then you try to find it, and then hopefully you find it in enough time to lie about how many times you found it and hit it again. But I was with these guys, and we're having a walk. And we were talking about all the things that you talk about in that circumstance. We talk about, oh, don't don't look at your super because your super's, you know, all that stuff, and how the grandkids, and I wish I lived up where it was warmer, and all that sort of stuff. Have you taken your medication? All the stuff we talk about. And we got talking, and about the 15th experience of the hitting these little balls and trying to find them, one of the guys, we've been talking about religion. And he said, you know, religion's really stuffed everything up. That's a sort of theological statement. Religion's really stuffed everything up. And he was arguing that in the old days, people weren't really exposed to different religions' points of view, and that's why we get extremism. And he was talking about this, and we were all sort of arguing, but we were all sort of having our say about that. And then by that stage in our walk, everybody knows what I do, and then it's all, you know, what about you blokes and the Crusades, and on we go. But then he concluded, he said, this might be the reason that people think that their religion is the only right religion. And the other guy said, yeah, that's probably a good call. And then he teed up this little ball and hit it into the dam. And that's what he did. But that's the atmosphere we live in. It's the atmosphere I live in. How do you give an answer for what you believe without coming off as the religious jerk in the corner or the person who hasn't thought through what they believe? How do you do it with gentleness and respect? There's a man called Professor Alvin Plantinga, and he wrote this, or he had this experience. One of his students, he's a college lecturer, and they asked a very valid question. I've thought about this question a lot since I read it a few years ago. The question was this: Professor Plantinga, Mr. Goodman, if you had been born in Morocco instead of Michigan, he's in Michigan, you would most likely be a Muslim instead of a Christian. And that's why the student said, I'm an agnostic. What you now believe is just a byproduct of where you were born. You ever thought about that? There's some truth in that, isn't there? Like, I was born in 1965 in Northern Ireland into a predominantly Christian atmosphere. So there's a good chance, isn't there, that I'm going to be raised in that atmosphere and be exposed to Christianity more than anything else. Now, if I was born in Mumbai, there's a good chance that I would be raised in an entirely different atmosphere. So there's some truth in that, isn't there? Would that be right? Yeah, yes would be the answer. Yeah. All right, well done. So the fact is that where we were born and how we were raised does have a huge impact on how we form what we believe. And sometimes we think as Christians, if we can just get our kids and grandkids into a Christian atmosphere, that will mean that forever in their life they will be Christian. Now, there's a good chance, or there's a better chance than that, because they'll be exposed to that. But the same is true of other faiths and other religions. So what do we do with the tension of that? Now, I'm not saying that everyone from Belfast and Northern Ireland is a Christian, or everybody in Mumbai is a Hindu. But that's the reality of our experience. So, in our hearts, we are to revere Christ as Lord, if we're Christ followers, and be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks for the reason that we have this hope in us, but we have to do it with a gentleness and respect. To not automatically just go to the you're wrong and I'm right discussion. So we've been looking at some of these vital questions that we need to ask. Or need to address, because we get asked them. We want to be a place, a church, that hold to not unquestioned answers, but give reasonable reasons as to why in 2020, whatever it is, 22, I believe, that we are still gathering on a Sunday morning in the freezing cold, and we are being in a place where we worship God and sing, "You're the light of the world, Jesus, you're the Savior of my soul." If somebody asked you at lunch today, why do you do that? Well, what would you say? Well, it's not because you don't have anything else to do on a Sunday. It's just because, I hope, that you revere Christ as Lord. So we've been looking at that. So I wanted to today look at at following Jesus in the posture of those who follow Jesus in the atmosphere of other beliefs and worldviews. And I want to do it by retelling you some of the story of this amazing man, this amazing person called Saul. He was amazing and wonderful on one hand, but he was a very damaging person on the other hand. And you might not know his story. You might have heard me over the years say, and as Paul said, not just Paul Masson, I'm talking about the Apostle Paul that wrote and was inspired to write, well, about a third of the New Testament under the direction of God. So I want to tell you that story and tell you a little bit about how he took the zeal he had for what he used to do, and God somehow transplanted that zeal into something better, far better. Now, for those who've been around church, you'll have heard his story, but I'll try to make it as thumbnail as I can. But for those who haven't heard it, it's important that you know. So this man called Saul, who later became Paul, he treated people really badly. Now, he did a bad thing with what he thought was a justifiable reason. Now, Saul was a man. He was a Greek-speaking Jew from Asia Minor. His birthplace was a place called Tarsus, which was a major city in a place called Sicilia. There was a region, a Roman province, and Paul grew up there in his adulthood, up to his adulthood. And that's important about his worldview. Until kind of the midpoint of his life, which back then probably would have been about 12, but the midpoint of his expected life, as he was an adult, Saul was a member of a group of religious people or a sect called the Pharisees. I'm sure you've heard of the Sadducees. The Pharisees, they were a religious pack or party that emerged during the Second Temple period, if you want to know the technical reason. Now, Saul the Pharisee reflects the character of the Pharisaic movement in his day. Pharisees were very careful students of what we now know as the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. And Saul was able to quote extensively from that in a Greek translation. So that's really important because he was able not just to speak Hebrew, but also Greek. By his own account, Saul was the best Jew, this is his own account, and the best Pharisee of his generation. If there would have been a Top Gun of Pharisees, Saul would be Maverick, if you've seen that movie. Go and see that movie, if you're allowed to do that religiously. He was the best of the best, right? So you got that image in mind. Get rid of Tom Cruise, Saul. Later in the story, Saul describes what his life was like before his life-changing event. He said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus of Sicilia, brought up in this city. I studied under Gamaliel, who was thoroughly trained in the law of our ancestors, another law of the Old Testament. I was just as zealous for God as any of you are today. You get that reference in Acts chapter 23. So we meet Saul, the very first time we meet Saul in the scriptures, many of you know this, is he is not at some religious gathering, he is at a lynching, he is at an execution, a religious execution. Because what had happened was Jesus had come, he had lived, he had died, he had ascended. A group of people who were people of the way, who were the first disciples of Jesus, started to gather and have influence, and Rome was a bit afraid of that, but the Pharisees were really afraid of it because people of the way believed something different to what they believed. They believed Jesus was actually the Messiah, and they didn't believe that. So while they were stoning a man called Stephen, who was the first martyr in the New Testament, he was a Christ follower. Stephen prayed out, Lord, receive my spirit. You can read about this in the book of Acts chapter 7. And then Stephen fell on his knees and he cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said that, he fell asleep. Well, he didn't fall asleep. He died. He was killed for what he believed about Jesus Christ. But the last sentence is what I want you to take your eye to. And Saul approved of their killing him. In fact, he was holding their coats. He may not have thrown the stone, but he was holding their coats. Saul sincerely believed that he was doing something that God would approve of. How many things have been done in our world by Christians and other religious folks that seemingly seem like a mission from God? Saul sincerely and zealously believed that those who disagreed with him and the Pharisees would mislead Israel and they should be removed. They should be stopped by any means possible. In prison, execution, didn't matter to Saul. He just wanted to get rid of the people of the way. And this became the mission of Saul's whole life. Now, he is sincere in believing that this is a godly mission. In fact, continually through the writings of Paul, who was then Saul, he sort of gives his CV about what he was like. He said, I was circumcised on the eighth day, in other words, I'm a good Jew, like the people of Israel and the tribe of Benjamin. I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, and as for my zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, I was false. In other words, I was not only a good Jew, I was not only a good Pharisee, but I was better than anyone else around me at doing this. And out of that mission from God, I believed, I'd come to believe, that my mission was to get rid of people who thought or believed differently from me. That's what zeal looked like for God, for Saul. Zeal for God was a willingness to do anything to fight God's enemies and to eradicate them from the planet. See, you can believe that you're on a mission from God and be completely, sincerely wrong. And this didn't happen back in the old days. A little girl in Toowoomba, just a couple of weeks ago, I won't even put a photo on the wall because I just can't look at that. A group of people decided the way they read the Bible was that this little girl who was a diabetic and 8 years of age should be denied that medication and prayed for, and if she died, they would pray for her resurrection. And Elizabeth died. And it was all over our news, and rightly so. And rightly so. You see, you can be convinced that you are on a mission from God and still be completely wrong. And do damage in the name of God that has nothing to do with God. And we'll get to that a little bit later on. I'm crackling a bit here, I don't know if that's me or the assistant. Saul would say, in my advancing of Judaism, beyond many of my own age among my people, and I was extremely zealous, that's an important word, for the tradition of my fathers. And that led, at one point, for him to be standing watching another human being put to death for no other reason than that human being believing something different to what he believed. So I'll get to the event. In Acts chapter 9, we're told that in amongst all of this, something dramatic happened to Saul. And we've seen a little video about that. It says, meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out his murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. So he went to the high priest and asked for letters to the synagogue in Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, that is, followers of Jesus, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. So Saul is at the height of what he believes is his mission from God. Let me change mine.
He didn't really mind what the process was. He just wanted to get rid of them. So he had a zeal, zero tolerance for everyone to believe. But we're told in the story, and this is Acts chapter 9, but in amongst all of this mission from God, let's get rid of all the Christians, the Christ followers, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around Saul. Now, I want to make a comment about this. Not every conversion experience, in fact, I would say the majority of conversion experiences are not like this, not in my experience. But something dramatic happened to this man, Saul. Suddenly a light from heaven. So the story goes that Saul falls to the ground, maybe thinks, well, this is like Moses, I'm going to see the glory of God because I'm such a good God person doing a great God mission. His zeal for mission is going to be rewarded by heaven itself, and I'm about to see the glory of God. But then something completely unexpected happens in his experience. Saul is not commended by God or this presence for his zeal or his mission or his sincerity. Saul is rebuked. And a voice from heaven says, I am Jesus. But before that, a voice from heaven said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul said, well, who are you, Lord? And the voice said, I am Jesus, whom you persecute. But rise up and enter the city, and I will. It will be told to you what you must do. That's a weird experience, isn't it, for anybody? That's what's known now as the Damascus Road experience. Some of our sporting stars have a Damascus Road experience, or our politicians, or anybody who's stuffed up in a public way and they want to get back to where they want to be. But in that one moment, all of Saul's dreams are shattered. In that one moment, all his dreams also will be fulfilled, and he doesn't even know that yet. Saul did not at that point stop or cease to believe in the God of Abraham, of Isaac, of Jacob, of Sarah and Rebecca, the faith of his Jewish heritage. Saul had been absolutely zealous for God, but tragically, he had been zealous about what zeal actually means. He was blinded to that reality. Saul finally sees the kind of zeal that God requires. And he'll find out that it's not a zeal to kill your enemies. It's not a zeal to persecute or diminish anybody who believes things that are different to you. It's a zeal for God. It's a zeal for love, the love of God, the love of others. It's a zeal to forgive, to embrace, to break down barriers, to not put walls up. It's a zeal to recognize and realize that those who we thought were our enemies are loved also by God.
Thank you.
be prepared to give an answer, but do it so that when people ask us, that we give an answer, but we give it in a particular posture. We give it with gentleness and respect. I wonder how, if you ask people generally about us, you know, if you're overhearing a conversation about you, I wonder if the words gentleness and respect. But gentleness and respect is a really good way just to live life, isn't it? We follow the one who described himself as inviting us to come and take on his yoke, his way of life. And he then described himself, Jesus did, as saying, "For I am humble and gentle." So humility and gentleness and respect are not signs of weakness or wussiness, to use a theological word. They are signs of a changed heart, a gentle heart. I maintain that shouting at anybody doesn't really do anything except create a little bit of noise. I laugh sometimes when my kids were young and they'd say, "Don't yell at me, Dad." And I said, "If I yelled at you, your hair would be moving." You know, gentleness and respect. So Saul now is physically blind and he's led to by the hand into a home in this place called Damascus. Some of you have not been to the home, but you've been to Damascus. And God comes again in the vision. Again, this is kind of stuff that most of us are not kind of familiar with, but this is Saul's experience. And God comes in a vision to another follower of Jesus by the name of Ananias. And Ananias is given a mission. And the mission is to go to the house in Damascus and ask for a man from Tarsus called Saul and pray for him for his sight to be restored. And I don't want you to miss this detail because this is Saul that Ananias has been asked to go and minister to. Saul, whose life... his mission up to that point had been to get rid of people like Ananias. Now, Ananias, unless he was living under a rock somewhere, is likely to have known who this Saul of Tarsus is. Because people get famous and infamous, don't they? Ananias is believed to be one of the disciples from Jerusalem who had to escape and run for his life because of people like Saul. So this is no small mission. This is not just pop round to your neighbours with some sugar and milk. This is a big deal for Ananias, who may well, we don't know, have had loved ones or even family members imprisoned or even killed because of Saul or men like Saul. So Ananias does what the vision asks him to do. He goes to this house in Damascus. And Ananias went to the house and entered it, and he placed his hands upon Saul and he said these two remarkable words, which I've put in red, "Brother Saul." Remember the context of Saul and Ananias. But now somehow Saul, whose life mission was to eradicate the earth of people like Ananias, is now calling him "Brother Saul." That's no small thing. Saul, the killer, the persecutor, the zealot on a mission from God, now a follower of Jesus, of whom Ananias is one, is now his brother, not his enemy. Honestly, if it were me, I would have passed on the mission. I mean, let's be honest, wouldn't you? I would have passed on the mission. I would have went, "Nah. Go and get somebody else to do that stuff." The enemy of Ananias has become now brother Saul. In fact, Saul, when he then became Paul, I know that's confusing, but that was a Bible thing to call people by different names to indicate change in their lives. Later on, when Paul tried to get into fellowship with the first church, most of the first church said, like I would say to that mission, "No. God, your grace is sufficient for me and the people I think it's sufficient for, but this guy is too far gone. This guy isn't, there's not enough grace in the world for this guy." And it took another guy whose name was Barnabas, he was known the son of encouragement, to speak for Paul and say, "No, this man should not be denied the grace of God. We should call him brother as we call each other brother." I was reading, I don't know where I was reading this, anthropologists have a wonderful phrase for this. They talk about what's called fictive kinship groups. You've been reading about that lately? Fictive kinship groups. I'll send you the link. And these are people in our lives who are not our biological family, but become part of our relational so much that they become relational family, that they become like an honorary family member. We all grew up with them, didn't we? Uncle whatever and auntie whoever, and I was related to 100 people. I didn't know why. They didn't look like me, but they were part of my church family, you see. Well, this, we hope, is a fictive kinship group where our relationship is just more than we have a passing interest in singing three songs and listen to a fella on a Sunday. But we are family. We are part of the body of Christ. That we have a greater responsibility for each other than just a passing glance. That's why one of the analogies of the New Testament is that we are a family. Brother Saul. Now, nobody would extend this fictive kinship group more radically and more inclusively than Jesus. And then later, Saul, who became Paul. He became a student of how Jesus was with the religiously other. I'll tell you a quick story. I'm not going to go on too much about this. But in Luke 9, Jesus and his disciples are going to a place and they have to go through a Samaritan village. If you know your Bible, you know the Jews and the Samaritans hated each other. It's the Hatfields and McCoys in that sense. That's the area there. And they're going to this place called Samaria. And what happened as they were going through, the Samaritans and Jews didn't get on well. They didn't care who knew. And that's why the Good Samaritan is such a shocking story to the Jewish ear. The Samaritans did not welcome Jesus, so his disciples rebuked them. And they asked Jesus this really important question. They said, Lord, Master, should we just call fire down from heaven, because we've seen you do all this stuff, should we just call down fire from heaven and destroy them? Not a lot of gentleness and respect back in the day, you know. So in other words, these people believe something different to us. Our solution, James and John's, the sons of thunder, let's smoke them. That's what he's asking, isn't it? Let's just get rid of them. So before we are too judgmental about Saul, we have the disciples of Jesus who have walked with Jesus, seen Jesus do what Jesus does. They come into a situation where they're in an atmosphere of someone who believes differently or acts differently or whatever, and their solution is the same solution as Saul. We're on a mission from God. So anybody who thinks differently to us, believes differently from us, they should not only be dismissed, they should be smoked. Fire from heaven. The Bible tells us that Jesus didn't rebuke the Samaritans, he rebuked his disciples. Jesus loved and served and cared people for people who believed things that were different to what he believed. Canaanites, Roman centurions, Samaritans, people who didn't believe what he believed and promoted. Jesus did not take a spear in his hands like Judas Maccabeus, who was the hero of the day, and try to eradicate those who believed differently. He would die on a cross and take a spear in his side so that people could have their sins dealt with once and for all on the cross. You see, for Jesus, zeal was to lay down his life for another. And once Saul met Jesus and became Paul, he would never, ever look at religious zeal the same way again. Now, what we know about Paul's character is that he would have been a zealous atheist. It was just part of his makeup. He had a tremendous drive in him. But now he discovered that zeal can be had, but it has to be channeled in a thing that honours God, not that masquerades as a mission from God. We live in our world every day. I hope we do. And people are on a mission from God. They believe that somehow destroying their perceived enemies of God is in fact an act of service to God and glorifying to God, and it's not. It's not. Let's smoke them. Let's pound what we believe into them. If we yell loud enough what we believe, they will believe too. Let's pound the devil out of them. Well, that's not the posture of Jesus. That's not the posture of his way. That's not the posture of his disciples. Jesus said this thing. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven. For he who does the will of my Father in heaven." And then he says, "Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, were we not prophesying in your name and we cast out demons in your name? And we denied little girls their medication in your name. And we ostracized people in your name. And we killed people in your name. And done many wonders in your name. And I will declare to them, I never even knew you. Depart from me, for you practice lawlessness. We've got to be real careful about what we project as the mission of God in our zeal to seek to serve God. Not all that is done in the name of Jesus brings glory to his name. So what does zeal look like for us? Well, a good start is from the writings of Paul himself. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, but cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honour one another above yourselves, never lacking in zeal. But keep your spiritual fervour serving the Lord. Be joyful in your hope, patient in your affliction, faithful in your prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need and practice hospitality. Man, if we could do that, like those first disciples, we would turn the world upside down again. It is possible to be zealous about the right things. The zeal means that we just don't tolerate or dismiss people of other worldviews, faiths, religions, but we are called to answer the question for the hope that we have in us with hope and gentleness and respect.
My shadow in the fading light is stretching out towards the night. Cause the sun is low and I hear there's still so far to go. My lonely heart is beating so tired of the wonder. There's a sign ahead, though I think it's the same one again. But I'm thinking about my only friend, so I'll find my way home. Swing.